thank you for joining us here at First Baptist Church of Yazoo City. Of all the choices you have to make today, I am honored that you have chosen to worship with us in the comfort of your home. As you sit back, would you also participate in the service and allow the Lord to transform your life? For that's why we are here today. Thank you again for joining us. May God bless you today.
How we want to start the new year out, saying, Lord, blessed be your name. No matter what comes our way, we're going to stand, we're going to praise. Let's sing this today.
Blessed be your name in a land that is plentiful, where streams flow.
Let us pray. Father, indeed, blessed be your name. Father, thank you for your blessings in 2015. And Lord, as we look forward to this year, thank you, Lord, in advance for what you're going to do here among your people. Father, we praise you. We give you thanks and praise for everything that we have and everything that we will have this year. Father, I ask you to bless us this morning as we come to worship together you. May our praise, may our hearts be focused in on you, Lord. May we listen to the message that you have given Brother Clint today. And Lord, may we be doers of the word, Lord, not just hearers. Thank you, Lord, for being a part of our lives and allowing us, Father, to be your sons and daughters through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you. If there's any person here today, Lord, who doesn't know you as their personal Lord and Savior, may today be the day that they come to know you, that 2016 will be a year, Lord, that they'll never forget. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. storms of life come, God is there. God says, just be still. Know who I am. And, you know, in these days with the new year, many folks have come through many things, and you're thinking, man, it's sure good to be 2016. At the same time, we've got others, so 2016 is just kind of looking a little daunting. We can take rest in knowing that God is in control. Even we know that there's floods actually headed this way again for us. We know that God is still above it all. Let's stand together. Let's sing this declaration to the Lord. Oh God, you are my God, and I'm going to ever praise you.
Thank you. message of Jesus Christ is of the utmost importance. And many places in the world, just they simply do not have access to that message. So my family and I, that's our commitment, is to go to places where Christ has not been preached.
As a mom and a grandma, we've tried to teach our children that to follow Christ means to follow Him completely, to be willing to give up, to be willing to sacrifice whatever it takes. But the day came, our baby son, we got a phone call in the middle of the night, and he had been in a really bad car accident. Him and our daughter-in-law were in surgery, and I was that morning outside hanging out clothes on the clothesline, and an airplane flew over. And I can remember thinking, oh Lord, please let me get on that plane so I can be there and I can see my son with my own eyes. That was a hard time. Hard time in our life, because we wanted to be there for them and we couldn't. But you know, just shortly after that, I watched this old woman climb from the valley all the way to the top of the mountain where we were teaching, and she barely made it, and her name was Mema Busa Busa. I remember the day that Mema Busa came to Christ, and at that moment I knew that no matter what I had to sacrifice, it was worth it.
The story of King George is a long story with many ties to the Lottie Moon Offering and Cooperative Program. It was just an exciting time in our ministry to see the miracle of an old man in our culture come to know Jesus as his Savior.
I can remember this grandmother at her lowest moment in life heard the story of a Savior.
Worship Jesus with me.
That afternoon in the village, she accepted Christ. She continues to be faithful in our Bible studies and learning how to share Christ with others. And you know, if you wouldn't have given, and if God wouldn't have allowed us to go, we would never have been a part of her story. And because you've given, you're a part of her story in providing a way that she heard the truth of the gospel, and now she follows Him among the mountain Basutu. And so no matter the cost, no matter the sacrifice, my family and I have decided that it's worth it and that we'll climb the mountains as long as the Lord keeps us physically able.
And as we do that, through your gifts, Christ is exalted, the name of God is made great, God is glorified through His plan, through His eternal plan of Christ being exalted to the nations.
The reason we showed that video this morning is twofold. One, as we continue to collect our Lottie Moon Christmas offering and pray for the Lord to continue to see people saved across the world, and impress upon us the need to give and to give sacrificially. But the main reason I show that is we'd already talked about Jim Flora. And Jim was a college classmate of mine who has made a plea asking for believers and churches as a whole to pray for rain. Now, you and I don't want to pray for that right now, here. But in the mountains of Lesotho, people they are working with or begin to question the greatness of God, because it has been so long since they've had a rain. This is not the season for rains, and the drought is pretty severe, including this weekend. His message this morning was that had a health clinic over the weekend, and many people were coming with diseases and things that were due to the lack of rain. And so I want us to spend some time this morning praying that the Lord would send rain. We sing how great is our God, and we believe our God is able. God can send rain there at a time when rain's not supposed to come seasonally in that culture, in that climate. It's rained a little bit there in the last few weeks as I followed this story. But it'd be a light sprinkle, and the people would celebrate and begin to declare how great God is. And God does hear our prayers, and then the rain stops. And just as we often do, we forget about the blessings that God gives us, and we begin to question once again. So I want us to pray this morning as we continue to give and give sacrificially, that the Lord also would give in the form of a rain in that land. And secondly, I want us to pray also today for Chile. We know our Chile mission team leaves 2 weeks from Thursday. And I ask you to be praying for our team. But today, a service is wrapping up there, and the missionary was meeting with the church, which we'll be working in the community, sharing with them their responsibilities and the things that they need to do to prepare for us and some obligations they need to fulfill while we're there. And that meeting needs to really go good. Those folks need to say, yes, we're willing to do this. If they don't, we're going to be able to make it around. But for them to have ownership and to partner with us, we need to pray that as Chad was sharing with them, maybe even still right now, that the Lord is working in their hearts and opening their eyes to the lostness that surrounds them and their role in reaching their neighbors. So let's pray together this morning, specifically for these two needs that exist and our involvement in those. Father God, we realize that indeed you are able. Lord, we sing how great you are, for you sent your Son to die on the cross for our sins so that we could be saved. You give us the daily bread that we need. You give us abundantly more than we ever deserve. And Lord, we just pray today for those that are not as fortunate as us, those in Lesotho that are struggling. And I thank you for Jim and Teresa and their ministry among these people. And I just pray, Father, that now you would send rain so the people would see how great you are. That, Lord, that you would send the rain in a time when they don't expect it. Not just to alleviate the physical pain and suffering that's there, but to demonstrate your greatness and to open up doors for Jim and Teresa to continue to share about you. Lord, we know there are many others in similar instances, and just pray, Father, that today that you strengthen them and you work in the lives of those that are serving. Lord, would you continue to press upon us the need to give and to give sacrificially, to give more than we've ever given before, for the need is greater than it's ever been before. Lord, I pray today for the meeting in Chile, that as Chad shares with the church what they need to do to prepare for us and their partnership in the ministry, that Lord, that you would open the eyes of these people to the lostness that surrounds them, and that they would be excited about the partnership that exists, and they would do what needs to happen, Lord, so that we see more people in heaven and less people in hell. Let your glory be shown in this place and to the ends of the earth. For, Lord, we want to make your name great. Speak to us now through your word and by your spirit. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. This morning, if you'll join with me in Philippians chapter 3, maybe a familiar passage to you as we do look at the new year and the new opportunities that lie before us. Paul writes to the church at Philippi, starting in verse 12 of Philippians chapter 3, "Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." The story is told of a widower who moved into a retirement community to spend the rest of his life there. And it wasn't long that he thought, I need to make the best of this, and begin to get to know some of the other residents and develop relationships with them. But there was one particular lady that he grew really fond of, spent a lot of time with her, and they flirted with each other. And he decided that he was going to ask this lady to marry him. So he made arrangements for that and set up that time, and the opportunity came, and he asked her, and she accepted, and they celebrated, and they went back to their rooms, and they went back to bed. He woke up the next morning. He couldn't remember her response. And so he went to her, and he said, "I'm so sorry. I said, last night I asked you to marry me, and I can't remember if you said yes or no." She said, "I am so glad you came up to me. For last night I knew that I said yes, but I couldn't remember who I said yes to." Sometimes we may feel that way about the new year. For as we look at the beginning of the year, we often will step back and think about some things that we said we were going to change last year. some differences that were going to occur in our life. And oftentimes we'll look back at this point in time over last year and think, well, you know what? I didn't do very good. I really wish I could forget some of that. I think we have that problem spiritually as well. For many times we say, Lord, this year I'm going to turn over a new leaf. Lord, this year I'm going to become more active in your work. This year I'm going to start praying more, reading my Bible more, maybe some other spiritual discipline. Or Lord, this year I'm going to start giving more. This year I'm going to start attending church more. This year is going to be a new year for me spiritually. And then we look at this point in the year over the previous year and, well, we say those same things once again. Lord, I'm going to start doing things a little better. You know, there's probably some things as you look back over the last year that would bring you joy and bring you excitement. Things that warm your heart, things that excite you to have those memories. But there are also probably some things you would rather not bring up. Things that bring you shame, heartache. And the same is true for our church and for each ministry in our church. And we're going to talk about that a little bit in a couple weeks from now. Two Sunday nights from now as we have our annual meeting. We're going to celebrate the last year, look ahead to this year. And I challenge you to be there for that time. But we have those things in our church as a whole. And the new year will give us individually and as a church new opportunities to grow spiritually, new opportunities to serve, new opportunities to see lives changed, both individually and as a church. But for us to be spiritually effective as a church, each one of us, as individual parts of the body of Christ, must be spiritually effective. And to reach that standard, there are some realizations that we must come to understand. Paul uses athletic imagery many times in his message or in his writings, and this case is one of those where he talks about striving toward. But if you look to chapter 4, verse 1, he says, therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy, my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I believe as you look at that in the context of what Paul is writing, Paul is showing us how to stand firm. He's showing us how to come to realizations, some things that we need to do in our spiritual lives so that we can stand firm. For this time, there is no greater time in our lives, in our world, within our church, that you and I need to stand firm to what the Lord has called us to do. So let's look at these realizations. The first one I see is the trap of dwelling in the past. If you and I are going to be spiritually effective, we must realize the trap of dwelling in the past. Throughout his ministry, Paul, we know, kept a single-minded focus. You see, over and over again, he refuses to get caught in the arguments that are going on around him. He stands up and pretty well puts an end to those. You see other instances where Paul is trying to be distracted, and he remains focused upon what the Lord has called him to do. To describe this focus that he had, Paul employs the image of a runner in a race who hopes to win the prize. Now, I hadn't done a whole lot of running. You can look at me and tell. Many of you haven't either, but to run, if you're going to run effectively, you can't look back. For when a runner would tell you, you have to keep your eyes focused on the end. For any time you look back, any time distraction that's there, it slows you down. It can take you off course. And so as Paul is talking about the race that he's running, he knows he can't cloud his mind with past memories. So he looks back and he sees the failures in his own life of being a persecutor of the church. He can't look back at those things, the imprisonments and the shipwrecks and the beatings that he endured. He has to let go of those things, the frustration of church members and false teachers. All these things, he says, are behind him. If you look at your life, you have some failures. You have some pain. There are some frustrations in your life that you must forget in order to be effective. So I think we need a lesson in grace today. For many times, the hardest person we find to forgive is ourselves. As the devil's accuser reminds us of our failures, he throws those things back up in our face over and over again. And we remember the failures and the disappointments and the pain and the struggle. And so as we're trying to run, we're looking back, and we cannot be spiritually effective. Now, while it's important to forgive or forget the negatives, we also need to forget the successes, which in the context here is what Paul is talking about. That's his major point. For Paul's laborers are the focus of this passage. If you look back at the previous verses, he has just spoke of his pedigree. He's talked about his upbringing and the family line and the the tribe that he was a part of. His point is that he refuses to rest on his past successes. He refuses to rest upon his education and his family line and the number of victories in the ministry and the number of churches that have been planted and the number of people that have been saved. Paul says he forgets all of those things as well. See, as individuals and as a church, we can get so caught up in the successes that we live forever in them. Maybe we dropped a sinful habit. Maybe we led somebody to the Lord. Maybe we started a new ministry. Maybe we started to fulfill some spiritual disciplines. Maybe we started doing some things in our life. We reached a goal, and we want to hold on to those things. We want to continue to pat ourselves on the back for those things. But as we continue to run the Christian life, as we look back at those, and we continue to celebrate those over and over and live in the past, it slows us down. We need to forget that the successes we enjoy are blessings from God in which he used us to impact his kingdom, and we often think we achieve those things on our own. We cannot dwell in the past. There are some that would tell us as a church that our glory days have passed. And indeed, you could look back at the great history of this church and you would see moments where many markers you would say are greater, especially that of attendance. And many would say, you know what, things have changed in Yazoo City. First Baptist has had its heyday, its glory day, and it's past now. And we keep looking back at them and we keep dwelling at those things. Let me tell you something. The God who was great in the past is also the same God that will be great tomorrow. And the God who blessed this church in the past is the same God who desires to bless this church today. We live in a community where over 70% of the people are lost. They're unchurched. And we want to think that our glory days have passed. But many of you also, there's some scars you've got, some things negative. Especially many of you who are in leadership positions and you had to make some decisions that maybe weren't very well thought of. And you know what? You've got some things you need to forget as well. Because you keep bringing those things up. And you keep thinking you can never move past those in your life. See, the temptation is for us to continue to rest upon the laurels of the church, what we did in the past. Or to bring up the scars of the past. And Baptists are the worst, all churches. We're great at living in the past. But it's vital that we realize the trap of living there. For we will never be spiritually effective if we live in the past. Even as we continue to look at the good things that happen. You know what I long for? What I hear now are stories that happened 20, 30 years ago in this church. I want somebody to celebrate and talk about the things that are happening now. I want us to make new memories. I want us to be so involved in the work of God that 20 years down the road, we talk about what's happening today. That our kids have something to celebrate and to talk about, and they have the heritage that many of you got to experience. But we must forget the past. Now, does that mean that we just flat out forget it? No, I'm not telling you that. I'm not saying we come up with some spiritual amnesia. What Paul is saying here is that he is no longer influenced by those things. And that's the key. Yeah, we have a great past. We need to celebrate that. We've got some scars from the past that we use those to make sure we don't make the same mistakes again. But those things cannot control our life. And that's what happens many times, is that we just continue to celebrate things happen or to hold on to those negative things happen, and they keep us from moving forward and being spiritually effective. And the first realization we must come to is that trap. A dwelling in the past. Yes, it's great, it's glorious, but so can be the present and the future if we will simply be obedient to what the Lord calls each of us to do and what he calls us to do then as a church. Another realization that we must come to is the progress that still needs to be made. Now again, Paul had just listed his spiritual pedigree. He says in verse 4, if someone thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, the people of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness based on the law, faultless. People would have loved to have been able to say that. That I live my life exactly as the law said. And if anyone had any reason to believe that they were spiritually mature, it was Paul. I mean, he had this background. And then after his conversion, we see what he did, how God used him. What we often forget is that Paul committed himself to being a disciple. There's about a three-year process there from his salvation to the start of his ministry where Paul's gone. And he was being discipled and prepared for ministry. He became a powerful communicator of God's word. He had the passion to stand up and defend the work of God. He was able to overcome the difficulty. He was seeing many people saved, yet he says he is not perfect. Matter of fact, he calls all that he did in verse 8 garbage. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ. To look at it all and say, that stuff is just trash to me, as I have so far to go. The word we would use today for Paul, we would look and say, he has arrived. He's done what the Lord wanted him to do. And Paul is stating that he is still very much in the Christian life. The perfection that he would have at the future resurrection was not yet attained. He still had to deal with what he calls in Romans the flesh, that innate sense, that innate pull to sin, where Paul says, what I don't want to do, I find myself doing, and what I do want to do, I find myself not doing those things. Paul knew he had not arrived. As he looked at his daily life, he was reminded how much further he had to go. For he had not attained the intense personal knowledge of Christ that he desired. He had not become all that God wanted him to become. He didn't press on out of personal willpower, though, but he pressed on because Jesus had chosen him and had taken a hold of his life. See, the fact of the Christian life is that the more that you mature, the more you realize how much further you have to go to become like Christ. It's a process. That the closer you get to him, the more you realize how much further you have to go. The lady in church, which I grew up in, I'll never forget when she made the statement that she had arrived. She said she was no longer tempted to sin, and that she felt that she was as close to the Lord as she would ever be, that she couldn't get any closer to him. She's very proud of this. And I remember as that high school student sitting back thinking, I don't think that's right, but I won't say anything. But I watched her as a college student, that same lady, through her sharp tongue and her unwillingness to let go of the past, cause a split in that church, where many people today still have the personal scars from her actions. And yet still to this day, as far as I know, she never would admit any wrong, and she would still say that she has arrived. She didn't see the progress that she needed to make. And that temptation is available and around every single one of us, especially the longer we're a child of God and the longer we are part of the church. For we think, what else can I learn? What else can I do? What else can I change? How can I be more effective? As I look across here today, several of you grew for the first time in your life. Some of you grew for the first time in a long time. For some of you, the first time ever you were involved in a small group. And you got to experience genuine fellowship, and you got to experience the Bible study that happened and the life challenge that occurred as you live life together. For Scripture says, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. And you got to experience that, and because of that, you made progress this year. Others of you started to serve. For the Lord spoke to you in this setting or in your quiet time or at other times and showed you needs that existed, and you started serving. Many of you participated in the I Love Yazoo Day. Huge day for our church. And we're going to talk about all these things and more in a couple weeks again. But know that progress was made in many of your lives. And it would be real easy for us to go, I started serving this year. Boy, 2015, I started serving. 2015, I was part of a small group. Sure was. Boy, it was good. Got to eat good, good fellowship. 2015, our whole church went out in the community. I was there. And pat ourselves on the back and think we've arrived and we've done all we need to do. But I assure you that as much progress as you made in this year, you need to make at least that much, if not more, progress this current year. That's for myself and for each one of us. You see, as I realize the progress I need to make and I grow closer to Christ, that's going to make me a better husband. It's going to make me a better father. It's going to make me a better pastor. It's going to make me a better in every relationship that I've got. Most importantly, it's going to make me a better child of God. And that affects every part of my life. And the same goes for you as well. Friends, we have progress that still needs to be made. And before it can happen in our church, in our community, it happens in each one of us individually. And we must come to that realization. And many times to do that, we have to quit dwelling in the past and have an honest assessment of our life and realize that progress. There's another realization that we must see, and that's the importance of determination. Did you catch the phrase Paul uses in verse 12? I press on, he says. And then he comes back and uses it again in verse 14. I press on. Now again, Paul is not pressing on out of his own willpower, but he realized that he had not become all that Christ wanted him to be. And so he pressed on again because Jesus had chosen him and had taken hold of his life on that Damascus road. And he brought a radical change to his life and had given him a radical message. And so he went out with that. That was his motivation. That was his power. Paul did none of this on his own. But he pressed on when it would have been very easy for him to stop. And then he uses the phrase and the image, I strain ahead. Straining toward what is ahead. Paul knew he didn't have an easy road ahead of him. He'd already been beaten and shipwrecked, already been in prison. He knew those things awaited him. He knew eventually his life was going to be taken because of his faith in Jesus Christ and the message in which he proclaimed. Yet, the image we have here is him straining every muscle in his body to achieve forward motion. His eyes were focused on the finish line, and Paul was giving everything that he could give so that he would be able to say at the end of his life, my life is being poured out like a drink offering. The time of my departure is at hand. I fought the good fight. I've kept the faith. I have finished the race. He had nothing left. I thought back to those Friday night football games in the locker room when the coach stood up to give his pep talk. And our coach wasn't a very pep talk kind of guy. He usually started off, if you can't get yourself fired up for this one, you're in bad shape. But then he would say, when you come back in here, be sure you left it all on the field. When you come back in here, don't you leave anything. Don't you have anything left. You leave it all on the field. I think that's the image that Paul has. There was nothing left when he got to the end of his race, for he had given every ounce of energy. He had strained toward the goal that God had given him. And he could look at his life and have no regrets. Wouldn't it be able to be great if each one of us could live our life, the end of time, we would look and go, wow, I have nothing left. For I gave it all, straining toward what's ahead. I'll be honest with you, one of the greatest frustrations as a pastor is seeing people quit. Is seeing people give up. Throw in the towel. Folks that were straining 1 minute are lying face first the next. Folks that are straining 1 minute, throw in the towel and walk back the other direction. Listen to me. I can promise you this is going to happen this year. Somebody's going to hurt your feelings. There's going to be a bumpy time in your life. Things aren't always going to be perfect. It's going to be easy to quit. The temptation is going to be there. Things aren't going to line up the way that you'd like. And you can quit and walk away. But when you do, you suffer. But the body of Christ also suffers as well. For it takes each part doing what we have been called to do, for us to be effective. And it's not going to be easy. It's not always going to be accepted. People are going to rub you wrong. But we must show that determination that comes when we realize that Christ has taken hold of our life and He has called us and He's given us amazing responsibilities, and we must strain toward the goal. Which leads to the last realization, and that's the focus toward the right goal. Paul uses in verse 12, I've not arrived at my goal. It's personal to him. But it wasn't something that he made up. It wasn't a path that he discovered himself. It wasn't something that he laid out. Rather, he shares this further in verse 14. I press on toward the goal. My goal becomes the goal, to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. I press on. There's that determination. But he says in verse 13, but one thing I do. Now, Paul did more than one thing. So many of you think your life's too busy and you can't do anything different. Listen, Paul made tents. He preached. He planted churches. He wrote letters to encourage other places where he had been. We see him investing in people personally. Paul did a lot of things. He was as busy as you are. And yet, Paul says at the top of his priority in life was to press on to the goal for the prize of the upward call of God. He is saying that the number one priority in his life is the kingdom of God. He was running straight toward that goal, and he was not going to let anything distract him from it. The word goal is where we get the word telescope from. It means a mark on which the eye is fixed. And Paul is saying he is focused in. He has got his eye specifically on the goal. He's got one thing in sight: reaching the goal in this life and the prize in the next. For he wants to win the prize. He wants to hear God call his name and summon him to the victory stand, where he will meet Jesus face to face and know him in perfect intimacy. Well, he would realize that earthly prizes do not last, but the eternal prize that was awaiting him would last. The goal can never be realized on earth, but it's a call that points us heavenward. 1 Corinthians 9, Paul says, everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. All of us today are happy. I don't know anybody in here that has a football team that lost. Well, you A&M fans. But at the end of the game, everybody got a trophy. That trophy, if you go to the football facility of every one of our favorite teams, will be displayed prominently. That trophy's not going to last. 30, 40 years from now, the Lord tarries, nobody will remember the victories that we all celebrated this past week. But the kingdom impact that we made this past week will be celebrated in 30, 40, 50, all of eternity. Where are our priorities? What is our goal? If we're going to be spiritually effective, we must telescope. We must focus directly toward the goal for the prize for which God has called us heavenward in Christ Jesus. In Facing the Giants, Coach Taylor challenges one of the team leaders, Brock, to give his best as the team watches on, to go to the goal, to be determined, to make progress, to forget. Well, everybody watches on. May this be us.
I get a good tight hold, Jeremy. All right, let's go, Brock. Keep your knees off the ground, just your hands and feet. There you go. A little bit left, a little bit left. There you go. Show me good effort. That away, Brock. You keep coming. There you go. It's a good start. A little bit left. A little bit left. There you go, Brock. Good strength. That's it, Brock. That's it.
I'm out of the 20 yet.
Forget the 20. You give me your best. You keep going. That's it. No, don't stop, Brock. You got more in you than that.
I ain't done. I'm just resting a second.
You gotta keep moving. Let's keep moving. Let's go. Don't quit till you got nothing left. There you go. Keep moving. Keep moving. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving it. Your very best. Your very best. Your very best. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. Don't quit on me. Keep going. Keep driving it. Keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. That's it. Your very best. Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving it. Don't quit till you got nothing left. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. I want everything you got. Come on, keep going.
It hurts.
Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go.
He's heavy.
I know he's heavy.
I'm bad out of strength.
Then you negotiate with your body to find more strength, but don't you give up on me, Brock. You keep going. You hear me? You keep going. You're doing good. You keep going. Do not quit on me. You keep going.
It hurts.
I know it hurts. You keep going. You keep going. It's all hard from here. 30 more steps. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Keep going.
Burn.
And let it burn.
My arms are burning.
It's all hard. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Come on. Keep going. You promised me your best. Your best. Don't stop. Keep going.
Too hard.
It's not too hard. You keep going. Come on, Brock. Give me more. Give me more. Keep going. 20 more steps. 20 more. Keep going, Brock. Give me your best. Don't quit! No! Keep going! Keep going! Keep going! Don't quit! Don't quit! Don't quit! Brock Kelly, you don't quit! Keep going! Keep going! Go, Brock Kelly! You don't quit on me! No! You keep going! You keep going! Go, Brock! 10 more steps! 10 more! 10 more! 10 more! Keep going! Don't quit! Give me your
heart!
You can! You can! Five more! Five more! Come on, Brock! Come on! Don't quit! Don't quit! Come on, Brock! Two more! One more!
It's got to be 50. I don't have any more.
Look up, Brock. You're in the end zone.
Each one of us is Brock. And the responsibilities, the call of God upon our life is what we carry. It's heavy. We get tired. It's easy just to quit. But the Lord is calling us, keep on. Keep on. And we do it because He's got a hold of our life and because the message He's given us is one that will change the world. And so we continue to go. And when He calls us home, we can stop. And we'll be in the goal line. We'll be in the end zone. We will realize complete victory at that time. Today, where's God calling you? See, for some of you, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. You've never placed your faith in Him. And you're carrying the weight of your sin. And the Lord wants to remove that sin from your life today. To teach you about grace and how you can forget what's behind. By simply just placing your faith in His Son who died on the cross for your sins and rose again. Others of you, there's things you're carrying that are tough. Maybe family related. Maybe work related. Maybe that God's calling you. There's something in your spiritual life that you're carrying and it's hard and you're wore out and you're ready to stop. But today, forget the pain. Forget the victories of the past. Let us realize there's progress that still has to be made. Let us have that determination that comes because of what God's done in our life and who He is. And let's get busy toward the goal. And let's do it today. See, one of the saddest scriptures is in Acts when Paul is preaching before the governor, Felix. And Felix is being convicted, and he doesn't really like what he's hearing. And he tells Paul, you go away, and I will summon for you when I get ready. And that time never came. And Felix never placed his faith in Jesus. Let us be like the psalmist who says, I will hasten and not delay to be obedient to you in Psalm 119. Let us now not hasten. Would you bow with me? Lord, let us instead be people who do not delay. Let us hasten. Let us come quickly now to answer your call for our life. Lord, there are some realizations that maybe many in this place have come to for the first time. Maybe they've been reminded of them today. And as we look at a new year and new opportunities that lie before us, Lord, we can't do it and be effective without you. Empower us now to make the decisions that need to be made in this time of commitment that drive our lives when we depart from here. Lord, we've sang about how great you are and how you're with us and how you're going to continue, and we give you glory and we bless your name. Let us now bless your name through our response to your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand together? And as we sing, if you have a public decision to make, would you come quickly this morning? The altar's open if you'd like to come and use it for prayer.
At this time, our service is a time for those in attendance to make public decisions as a response to hearing God's word and the Holy Spirit's leading in their life. Maybe the Lord has spoken to you today, and there's a decision that you need to make, or some questions that you need answered, or just some guidance that you need for some things you're facing in life. I'd like to invite you to call 888-JESUS-20, where you will be linked up with a counselor who can give you direction regarding the decisions that you need to make. You're also welcome to call us here at the church office on Monday morning, 746-2471. But I encourage you not to delay, not to wait until that time, but to right now take the time to make the decisions in your life which God is leading you to make. Again, that number is 888-JESUS-20.
Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, God, as the song says, I give you my heart and soul. I believe in you. Blessed be your name, Lord. May each of us as Christians and followers of Christ, step by step, we follow you through this year to come and the years to come, led by the Holy Spirit, Christ in us, to the world that we live. May 2016 and beyond, how great is our God in the lives and Lord that we believe in. May the tithes and offerings that we're about to give be the blessings and the outcome that you deserve, Lord. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
As always, I thank you for being here today. I'm a routine person. I like a schedule, and we are back on schedule this week. Not this evening yet, but as far as our Wednesday night services, hope you'll be here. There's a whole slate of things in your bulletin. Everything, I think, is next Sunday, so at least you'll have a little bit of notice there. But I encourage you to take that, look how you can get plugged in and be involved. A lot of things going on as we gear up for the new year, and I ask for you to be plugged in as God gives you the chance to do so. Lucas and Cray, if y'all would come. As you know, the newlyweds standing here, right before we came out, Lucas and me and his dad and Doug were all over here in the back room and trying to keep him from running out, and really didn't, but his daddy tells me, if you, or something along the lines of, you need to get him involved in church. If you need any help, you call me, sort of thing. And anyway, Lucas desires today membership in our church on promise of a letter from Wendell Baptist Church. And he made this statement standing here that he wanted me to share with you. He's not just he joining the church. It's the Jordan family joining the church. But even as Cray, it's a change growing up in the church. And Lucas, most people are still going to call their pickings for the next 30, 40 years. But there's a change in her from you seeing her grow up to now the marriage occurs and starting her family, them together, their family together, and starting their lives together, and the changes that they're going through. And they their commitment they're making is not just Lucas becoming a part of this church, but them as a family becoming a part of this church. And I highly respect that. I know you do as well. And as a sign of that and welcoming him to our church family, would you raise your right hand? And you see folks are going to pray for you and are proud of y'all today. And thank you for being here. I know you're going to want to encourage them and share that with them personally as we wrap up our service. So guys, if y'all will come back and stand here and I'll let everybody encourage you. And also, and my challenge to you is to pray for them as well. As a commitment, as you come through, you're making a commitment, you're going to pray for them, and you're going to grow with them. And so let that be our prayer today. Let's stand together. We're going to conclude by singing How Great Is Our God. He is indeed great. Let this be our testimony as we depart. Thank you.